Please read this disclaimer. This video's all the character and all of its contents, including any disease and opinions expressed by the narrator, are strictly for entertainment purposes only. And it is not intended in any way as a substitute for professional service and consultation from licensed therapist, doctor, attorney, or other licensed professional service provider. Each person must make their own life decision, and those decisions are theirs. Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-the-world news story with Revolving Time, where we bring you real-life stories that explore the complexities of the human experience. We hope that our stories have provided you with insights, inspiration, and a renewed appreciation for the power of human resilience. Today's story is about, my children found out about my wife's betrayal with the boss. When my kids and I dumped her, she finally realized what her lies and betrayal had done to hurt her 23 years of family and herself. Okay, let's go to the story and see what happened there. I was awakened early by the morning light and the singing of mountain bluebirds. I could hear the scamper of what was likely chipmunks running around the campsite trying to clean up any leftover crumbs from my previous night's freeze-dried backpacking meal. The peace and joy I felt being out backpacking after so many years quickly dissolved as the reality of what my day would bring came over me. The air was crisp and cool up here at 6,000 feet, and as I exited the tent I was engrossed by the beauty of the alpine lake, ringed by snow-topped mountains at my camping site. I wanted to stay longer, wished I could throw out my fishing line with a spinner or a fly attached, but I knew that today was the day I had dreaded for the last month, the confrontation that I needed to face quickly and with finality so I could begin again. I made some semblance of an egg sausage breakfast over the propane stove along with some thick black coffee. As I sat and finished my fuel for the 6-mile hike out, I marveled at how beautiful and peaceful this moment in time was. I reminded myself that yes, there can be beauty and enjoyment of life on the other side if you just keep moving forward with the right attitude. I knew I would certainly be getting back into camping, hiking, fishing, and sailing, just some of the hobbies I had let slide over my 23-year marriage to the love of my life. Well, make that the person I once thought with all my heart was the love of my life. Now I hoped there would at some point be another. The hike down was pleasant and uneventful, and I came across no one on the trail or parked at the trailhead as I packed up my car with my gear and started to drive out to the main highway. I turned my phone back on after being off-grid for the last 3 days and knew that when I got into range of a cell tower the texts, voicemails, and emails would begin. As I pulled out onto the 2-lane paved county road, I got the first beep of a text and looking down saw it was from my 21-year-old son Ryan. Ryan and I were not only father, son, but we were now actually the best of friends and confidants, having passed through the trials and tribulations of his wild teenage years and come out the other end respecting and loving each other greatly. Ryan's text was short and to the point, Dad, I love you and support you. Good luck today and stay positive. Somewhere, sometime there will be a light at the end of this tunnel. His pledge of support brought a tear to my eye and helped me justify what I had to do. The next text message that I opened was from my daughter Krista, and it too was a promise of backing and love. Dad, I wish I could be with you and hug you and tell you it will all be okay. You have been the best father we could have ever imagined, and always put us first. Now you need to put yourself first, whatever that may be, and know that Ryan and I love you and will always be there for you. Krista had always been a daddy's girl, and although she was the spitting image of my beautiful wife Linda in her younger days, Krista had my quest for adventure, love of the outdoors, and a crazy sense of humor, none of which Linda had as attributes. At least I had been blessed in my 23 years with children that I loved, respected, and would be the best legacy I would ever leave behind at the end of what I hoped would once again be a happy and fulfilling life. I pulled into a rest stop to give my texts, emails, voicemails, and missed calls a thorough review. There were 10 missed calls from my wife over the last 3 days, the first 7 or so likely from her 3-day banking seminar and supposed business trip to Vegas, and the last 3 appeared to be from her return yesterday evening and then again this morning. I could imagine how shocked she was when I wasn't at the airport to pick her up and when I didn't return any of her calls or texts. I didn't bother with the voicemails. I deleted them all and moved on to the balance of my incoming messages. Sure enough, Linda had texted me about 20 times over the course of the last 3 days, and again, I had not returned a single one. I skimmed through them, with the first few being her pronouncement of her never-ending love for me, and the last several being anger, dripping with indignation at me for not responding to her, not picking up her calls, and leaving her waiting at the airport for over an hour before she finally figured I wasn't coming. The last text from her was simply what the duck Jack. Update, how our relationship had changed in the last month, although from her standpoint I don't think she even realized how the spark of love in me that had burned eternally for her was ever so slowly being extinguished. I really couldn't understand this. Had she grown that far apart from me over her last treacherous 4 months? Had she really lost all conscious thought about me, my feelings, and the pain in my eyes that I was amazed she couldn't see? Had she that easily forgotten about her kids, our family, and the loving life we had shared for so long? That was perhaps more depressing than her affair. Linda was still beautiful at the age of 44, and she knew how to work her body for whatever the occasion was. Be it flirting at a social event, or playing the role of the rising star banking professional in the Trust Department of Commerce Bank. I had always been proud to be seen with her, and I enjoyed the way men would stare at her as we walked by, barely able to contain their lust and take their eyes off of her. Knowing that she was mine and her and I were entwined forever gave me a huge rush of self-esteem and ego. I told her how beautiful and desirable she was, but she would always counter that she was getting old and she just didn't feel as young, vibrant, and sexy as she once was. I could tell this bothered her, and I would try to assure her that her light was getting brighter, not dimmer, but she would just disregard my compliments by saying, "You just have to say that 'cause you are my husband and you love me." Perhaps the why for all of her lies and deceit was buried in those feelings of fleeting and lost youth, but I was pretty sure I would never know. Maybe she wouldn't either. Whatever the reason, her younger boss, John Monroe, had somehow become the new light of her life, at least in a sexual way, if not in a boring but dependable best friend way, which I was now evidently relegated to. Although to me, we had even passed beyond being friends, but again Linda never noticed it. John Monroe was wealthy as the vice president of the trust division, and he was lean, tall, and so self-confident that I found him obnoxious the few times I met him, but Linda thought he was the epitome of a great leader. At least that was what she used to say when we used to discuss her work life and him, but that abruptly stopped 4 months ago also. Looking back, I now assumed that was the start of her affair, the beginning of the end of 23 years together. I off my depressive thoughts, looked back at my phone, and with an angry snarl I deleted all of her texts and then went on to my emails. My lawyer's email told me that everything was ready to go, per my discussions with him. I also noticed that I had a Snapchat and I opened it up to read, "The person you were interested in had an accident while being mugged." When I closed the chat, it immediately erased itself. The next email I reviewed was confirmation that my resignation from work was accepted, and my $400,000 in stock options had been liquidated and the proceeds moved to my new checking account. I was flush, at least for a few years, although the tax would cut. But I really didn't care, I needed to be gone. Update 1. I was getting ready to pull out into traffic when the phone rang and I saw it was Linda. I decided that there was no time like the present, and equated it to pulling off a band-aid. It had to be done quickly and with conviction. I pulled over to a corner of the rest stop, turned off the car and answered the phone in as non-emotional way as I could muster. "Hey Linda, what's up?" "What's up? What the duck do you mean what's up? First of all, where are you? You weren't at the airport to pick me up and you weren't home all night. You didn't even leave a note and you haven't answered any of my calls or texts since last week. What jack? You tell me what's up." "Linda, I didn't think you would really care either way if I answered or not, or if you saw me or not. I figured you would be relieved that I wasn't home. That way you could clean yourself up and get back into character before you saw me, the kids, our friends or your parents. Isn't that how you make your double life work?" "What? Why would you say that, Jack? I don't even understand that." "What double life? You know I have to travel for work. And by the way, why aren't the kids answering any of my calls or texts? And where is our king mattress from the master bedroom? I had to sleep in the guest bedroom last night. Jack, what is going on and where are you and why did you leave me stranded at the airport? I feel like I am in the Twilight Zone and nothing is making sense." "Linda, you are in a type of Twilight Zone that you chose to put yourself and our whole family into." Linda's anger and aggressive verbal onslaught was trailing off as her confidence must have started to sink and her worst fears started to surface. "What? What does that mean, Jack? Where are you and what's going on?" "It doesn't matter where I am or where I'm going, but I'm out of town, Linda, and I've been too busy the last week to answer your texts and calls. I've been pretty busy trying to figure out how to move on from a major betrayal in my current life and move into my new life." Linda hesitated and her voice faltered at hearing the word betrayal, but she continued playing dumb and shouted, "What? Jack, are you drunk? What are you talking about? First of all, Linda, tell me, how was your 3-day banking conference? Did that as Hall John get to duck you every night and morning or just the 3 nights?" I could hear her gasp and pause as I said, and it took her several seconds to reply. "What are you talking about? John who and why would you say that? I'm married to you." "Yes, Linda, you are married to me, and I'm amazed that you still even consider this a marriage. So, are you at least going to give me the courtesy after 23 years of marriage to tell me the ducking truth?" I know you have had no respect or concern for me or your family for the last several months, but now that the lies and deceit are out in the open, how about being honest about it?" Linda replied in a shaky and soft voice, "Jack, I don't know what you are imagining, but you are wrong. I only love you. There is nothing going on with John Monroe and me." "Oh, well, at least you now admitted to knowing which John we are talking about. For a moment there, I thought there was more than one John." "Linda, tell me truthfully, did you think you would never get caught, or did you just not care? Were you working up to tell me that you wanted a divorce and loved someone else? It would have been so much easier for everybody if you had just had the courage to let us know before lying and cheating behind our backs." "Jack," Linda shouted, and I could hear the catch in her voice as she started crying, "don't even mention the word divorce. Please believe me, I only love you. Please come home so we can talk about this. Nothing is going on. How could you think otherwise?" Apparently, Linda was convinced that I had no proof and was bluffing, so she was going to keep up. "So, I guess that means you never ducked Monroe in our bedroom on our now-missing king-sized mattress." "No, of course not. What are you talking about?" "Linda, hold the line for just 1 minute, will you?" With that, I pulled up the photo of John Monroe ducking Linda. She looked like she was in ecstasy. This was one of many photos and videos I had from the button camera hidden in plain sight inside the dresser clock that I had bought a month ago when I was alerted to her affair. I texted the photo to Linda and hopped back onto the call. "Linda, pull up the photo I just sent you. Are you telling me that isn't my loving wife getting ducked in my master bedroom, on my king-sized mattress, with no rubbers, by her ducking boss?" I could hear her cry. "Oh God, no, Jack. Please, it was a mistake. It only happened once. It didn't mean anything. It was just the excitement of someone younger who wanted me and made me feel young again. It was a one-off and I truly never meant for it to hurt you. I'm so sorry." "But Jack, if—" I cut her off by yelling into the phone. "Linda, look out the back window at the middle of the backyard. Do you see that pile of charred wood, metal and ash? That's our ducking king-size mattress. That is symbolic of how you torched our marriage, how you betrayed our family, how you humiliated me. When did you start hating me enough to hurt me like that? When did you decide that you no longer cared about my love or our family's love? When did you decide I was no longer worthy of your respect or honesty? When and why did you decide to throw us out like the morning trash? Jack, please, please, forgive me. I love you. I don't hate you. I could never hate you. I want to spend my life with you. It was an accident, a bad mistake, and it was just the one time. It was me being selfish. It was never anything lacking in you. Please, Jack, come home and talk to me. Update 2. Linda, the kids and I have had enough of the lies and deceit. Can you just finally be honest with me? Is this why the kids won't answer my calls? Jack, did you tell them and turn them against me? How dare you, Linda? I didn't. You did that all on your own. Well, that is you and your duck buddy. This is all you. Your selfish, self-centered attitude and you need someone else's is what has put you in the twilight zone and what has taken our whole family and destroyed it and pushed us all away from you. And no, it wasn't me that told the kids, it was the kids that told me. How pathetic is that? I would have never thought you could lie and cheat on me and throw us away so easily. At least now stop your lying. It wasn't one ducking time. It's been going on for at least 4 months, judging by how you have cut us all out of your life emotionally. And the sad part is you didn't even realize it. You quit talking with us, quit looking at me, quit making love to me except for the rare mercy duck. You disgust me. Jack, it didn't mean anything. It was just sex, just the one time, and just a short lapse in judgment out of a 23-year marriage. It's you I want, not John. Please believe me. Linda, hang on. I pulled up the next picture from my phone, the one where Ryan had come home unannounced to pick up some tools and heard his mother and Monroe going at it. He had quietly snuck up to the open door of the master bedroom and reached his phone around the door jamb and took several pictures and some video. He was so distraught. He didn't tell me for 2 weeks until Krista and he finally decided I had the right to know, so they called me together and told me, and we all cried and were physically sick at watching the treachery of their mother, my wife, with her boss. That was what prompted me to buy the spy camera. I texted that photo to Linda too. Linda, open your phone again. This is the first time any of us knew about you and your ducking boss, although the way you severed all emotional ties to me 3 months prior to this picture, I am pretty sure you have been lovers for a long time. Linda, you were first found out by Ryan. How do you think your son feels about you after seeing that betrayal by his mother? Do you think that might have pushed him away and that you might have lost his respect and that of Krista when they looked at these photos and tried to decide whether or not to tell me about your cheating, slutty behavior? Do you think you have an ounce of credibility or respect from them now? Do you know how painful it was for them to tell me that you were a cheating slut and how hard it was to hear them cry their eyes out as they watched you shred our marriage and destroy our family? Just stop with the lies about how it only happened once and how it hasn't been going on for months and how you didn't duck him 6 or 7 times on this last business trip. I'm hanging up at your next lie. No, Jack, please let me explain. I could hear Linda bawling, and I imagined her crumpled on the floor as she was finally understanding what her lies and betrayal had done to hurt her family and herself. Jack, I'm so sorry. Please, you have to forgive me. I went insane, but it is over now. It was just cheap and it felt so exciting to be wanted and to be sneaking around in an illicit affair. I felt young and desirable again. But there was no love and I didn't ever want to hurt you, but I don't know how I couldn't see that I was. I didn't even realize how I had pulled away from you and the kids. I'm ashamed to say that it's just now that I am waking up and I see myself as some other person in a horror movie or nightmare. And I hate myself for it because I love you and them and our life together. Oh, dear Jack, please, please come home so I can make this right. I need to make us a family again. Linda, there is no us. We are done. You can't possibly believe you really loved me after the hurt and mental damage you have done to me. You've shown that you don't respect me, don't care about anyone other than yourself, and between your lies and deceit I can never trust you again. Everything we had before is now tainted and suspect. Did you duck him for the last several years or the last 4 months? How many other men have there been, Linda? Do I need to do DNA testing on my kids? Don't bother to answer because I won't believe whatever you say. For sure I need to do STD testing. There is nothing left for you and me. You've hurt me like no one else ever has and ever will, and I could have never imagined the person I loved and bet my life on would throw me away like a piece of trash. But you have. Maybe the kids will find their way back to you eventually. But I for sure never will. Final update. Jack, please don't say it. I'll do anything. I'll go to counseling. You can go duck other women. Please don't leave me. I have been living with the guilt and wanted to stop and would have. I would have always come back to you. This was just a meaningless fling. Oh God, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. Linda, save your breath. I don't believe a word you are saying, and at this point I just don't care about you and your lies anymore. Now listen to me carefully, because this is what's happening. On Monday, you will be served divorce papers at the bank. No, Jack, please don't divorce me. Please, Linda, listen to me. Your boss's wife by now has received copies of the videos and pictures that I have of your affair from the several times you ducked him in our bedroom. So likely you and ducking John Monroe will either be ending your relationship or perhaps you will be stuck with each other when his wife and I both dump you. Jack, please tell me you didn't do that. He has a wife and 2 kids. Why are you going to ruin them? Wow, Linda, you just don't get it. I'm not ruining them. You and John Monroe ruined them. Your cheap affair didn't just ruin my life, your life, and the life of our kids, but it's also going to ruin his wife and his kids. Are you proud of yourself? You've had a hand in destroying the lives of 8 people. Lucky for you that you're such a selfish bitch that you probably don't care. With that assault of cutting comments, her sobs exploded. But I wasn't done yet. Your boss will be served with a civil suit for alienation of affection, although the process server might have to find what hospital he is in. Evidently, he had a piece of bad luck. Wrong place, wrong time. I heard from a friend that Monroe was mugged in the parking lot at the airport and ended up in the hospital. So hard to say when he will be in shape to give you his magical C again. Stop it, Jack. I don't care about him, I just want you. Please don't do this to us. Listen up, Linda, again, there is no us. Hard to say if your boss and you will have jobs by the end of next week because I also sent these pictures to the president and board members of Commerce Bank along with an alienation of affection and a sexual harassment suit. If they want to settle, I'll try and make sure you stay employed, but I'll demand that they fire him for cause. No, Jack, no. Do you hate me so much? Linda, you are the one who showed your hatred for me by your betrayal, the lies and the disrespect. You took my love for you that I cherished. I'm just trying to reclaim some self-respect before our lives separate and we go in different directions. At this point, Linda was crying so heavily and uttering screams of disbelief and denial that I wasn't sure she could listen to me anymore. I was losing my anger and was feeling pain and remorse for what I was putting her through because I knew I still loved her even as I knew I also hated her. But overall, I was determined that I would have my revenge and then I would dump her for what she had done to me. Linda, we are almost done. Try and concentrate on these next few items. I have taken the $125,000 we had in savings and used $25,000 to prepay the next 2 years of Krista's college. I'll help her out in the future, but for now this is what I can afford. I am leaving you the house. I signed the deed over to your name and the equity is about $100,000 if you sell it now. I'm not selling our house, Jack, and I want you to stop this madness and come home to me so we can heal. Please, for the sake of our 23 years of love and happiness before I went insane. I ignored that comment. and continued, "Linda, if you sign the divorce, you keep the house and all of its contents. I keep the $100,000 that is left of our savings, and we are done. If you don't want to sign the divorce or fight it, I don't care. I won't be around for you to argue with. Do what you will, it doesn't matter to me. We are almost done, Linda. There are just a few other things I need to tell you. If you look around the house, you will notice I moved out. I've taken what I want, and anything that is left you can do with as you choose. I took our family vacation pictures. I left the wedding photo albums to you. Save them, burn them, I don't care. I left my wedding ring on our dresser. You can melt it down or flush it down the toilet like you did with our marriage. Ryan is coming over to pick up some of my fishing and hunting gear that he wants, and he prefers to come by when you are not there. So don't be alarmed if you notice someone's been in the house. He doesn't want to see you. Krista is coming over to clean out any of the possessions of hers that she wants. She doesn't plan on ever living there again. She also would like to come by when you are gone, so don't be surprised if you see her room emptied out. The last thing you should know is that I also texted the pictures of you and your ducking lover to your parents, my parents, and all of our contacts in both of our email databases, so you might want to work on what story you want to tell them all." Her crying and screams had now risen to a level where I was afraid she would pass out or have a stroke. This needed to end. "Linda, one more thing. I resigned from my job last week, and I am leaving the state for the great unknown. I'm hoping that I can find someone in the future that loves me enough to stay true to the promises we make each other. Someone that will respect me, treat me as a treasured equal, and someone that I can once again trust and love. I hope you can find what you evidently were missing from me. Please don't look for me. If you really need me for something, you can send a message through Ryan or through my lawyer, but I am out of your life, and you are out of mine. And there really isn't any more to be said. Goodbye, Linda." My reaction, I could hear her screaming, "Jack, no, no, please, Jack, please forgive me." As I hung up the phone and broke down into an anguished fit of crying and pain, I think I knew I had gone too far in exacting my revenge, and it would take a long time to forgive myself for the cruelty I showed. I doubted I would ever forgive her. I knew the road before me would be a painful one before I could heal myself and feel like I was ready for more than a life of solitude. More than anything, I didn't want to lead a life of bitterness, but I reminded myself as I thought about my morning on the mountaintop that there would still be moments of beauty and magic in my life if I could keep myself open to them and just keep moving toward a new beginning. Thank you for being a part of our journey, and we look forward to sharing more powerful stories with you in the future. We encourage you to subscribe to our channel and stay connected with our community. Remember, this channel exists because of your support, and I want it to be a place where we can all come together, learn, and have a great time. Your feedback is vital, and I appreciate every single suggestion and comment you provide. Take care yourself and see you soon.